Good afternoon. Welcome to the fourth lecture of the Science and Society series of Paraspar, organized by the Office of Communication, Indian Institute of Science. Today we have a very interesting lecture, German Immigrant Scientists and Engineers and Aeronautics in India by Jahnvi Phalke, who needs no introduction. But still, as a custom, I'm going to give a very short introduction of the speaker. Jahnvi Phalke is the founding director of the Science Gallery Bengaluru. She is a historian of science and filmmaker, formerly at King's College London. She is author of Atomic State, Big Science in 20th Century India, and has co-edited Science of Giants, China and India in the 20th Century. She is the producer director of the documentary film Cyclotron. Jahnvi reads civics and politics at the University of Bombay and at the School of Oriental and African Studies, London. She holds a doctorate degree in history of science and technology from Georgia Institute of Technology, Atlanta. We are very glad to have you, Jahnvi, and please give us your lecture.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bithasta, first, in the first instance, for the kind invitation to speak to what is very clearly an august audience of colleagues at the Indian Institute of Science, but also people from elsewhere. I'm really delighted to be presenting this work. I would like to begin by saying that this paper comes out of research that I started a while ago, but I haven't had the chance to actually begin writing about it, and I'm hoping to do so now. The lecture that I'm about to deliver, or the presentation that I'm about to give, is dedicated humbly to the memory of Professor Oddam Narasimha, with whose kind guidance and generosity I started on this work. I don't think I could have begun on this work without his support and encouragement and good humor with which he egged me on when I started on this. And I was I had just finished my PhD, and I was in Bangalore to, exploring, trying to see where this goes. And I met two remarkable people, Dr. Valluri, S.R. Valluri, and Professor Narasimha, both of whom I deeply miss. And the encouragement that I had, especially from Professor Narasimha, is something that I will carry with me. And I hope to bring this research to a completion not too far in the future. So allow me to share my presentation with you today. Ta-da. Here we go. And just let me know if you're able to see my screen. Is everything okay, Bithasta?
Yes. Yes, everything's fine.
Excellent. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a brief overview of three waves of German migration to India, especially migration of scientists and engineers, which is deeply implicated in the establishment of aeronautics in India, aeronautics research and aerodynamics research, and the manufacture, or culminating in the manufacture of aircraft for the Indian Air Force. So this is an exploration, in a term that I mentioned in my abstract, of exploring the military-industrial academic complex as it manifests itself towards the end of the Second World War and rather close to Indian independence. This aspect of the story is perhaps actually quite well known to people in the field of aerodynamics and aeronautics, but not more widely known. And I think in itself, it's an interesting story because the three waves of German migration hold contradictory values and contradictory motivations and manner of migration to India. Now, as I like to say, this story can begin in a number of places, but for today, or for the purposes of this presentation, I'll start with Ludwig Prandtl. Ludwig Prandtl is often called, he's credited with the establishment of the field of aerodynamics, and he had an interesting laboratory at the University of Göttingen, where students from across the world, including from India, went to study. Some of these remarkable students, actually play out even in the Indian story, but many of them during the war continued work in Germany, but also migrated to the United States. Some of them before the war began or ended, and some of them migrated to the United States after the war was over. And so as a part of what is called Project Paperclip, where after the occupation of post-war Germany, the Soviet Union, the United States, and the Allies occupied parts of Germany, putting an end to aerodynamics and aeronautics research and nuclear research, which had to be then carried out elsewhere. So in the case of nuclear research, in fact, the closer connections were developed by the Germans to the Spanish. And in aeronautics, entire facilities were picked up and taken, not just people, but actually equipment, were taken to the United States and to the Soviet Union. The culmination of that part of the story is well known in not only through the wonderful film Dr. Strangelove, but also Wernher von Braun and V-2 rockets. There is an equally interesting Russian story or a Soviet story, but today is not the day to explore those stories. Suffice it is to say that Ludwig Prandtl was central to the beginnings of aerodynamics research, and therefore the coming together of research in a university laboratory, manufacture in wartime facilities, but also therefore, you know, well, non-wartime facilities as well, so peacetime facilities as well, and the military, because the war followed so close at the end of the decade in which Prandtl laid the foundations of aerodynamics research in Göttingen. Prandtl had two Indian students, one Vishnu Mohan Ghadke, and the other was Nilen Bose. Bose moved back to India and worked with the Public Works Department and essentially continued work in while being with the public and public works department in hydraulics and hydrodynamics. But Vishnu Mohan Ghadke became an extremely important part of the foundations that were laid for the establishment of this connection between industry, academia, and the military. Ghadke came from Kolhapur in Maharashtra and ended up in Göttingen to do his PhD. He worked with Prandtl, came back to India in the late 30s, and 36, I think, is when he got his PhD. And he came back, he worked for a couple of years here and there in Maharashtra. So I think he was in Pune and Bombay for a bit in a teaching position, with excellent recommendation letters, of course, following from Göttingen. And then he was brought in to Bangalore for the establishment of two interconnected, at that moment, interconnected institutions, the Department of Aerodynamics at the Indian Institute of Science and Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. So Ghadke became increasingly interested and you know, carried out aircraft work in aircraft design. And this is something to bear in mind, because his leadership in aircraft design was something that would come to a head when another team would be called in to do to support, not just support his team, but in some ways supersede his team at the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. So as we all know, the Second World War broke out in 1939. The Eastern Front, so to speak, began flaring up by the early 40s with the Japanese occupying Burma. And that is when war, you know, came home, so to speak, on the Eastern Front. So efforts to contain the Japanese on the Eastern Front were strong, and Bangalore became an important center given its distance from the sea, so to speak, and an important headquarter for the work of the Southeast Asia Command, headed by Louis Mountbatten. Many important British scientists at that point of time also came. So, you know, the first overseas meeting of the Royal Society was held in 1944, which was the culmination, again, of several visits by scientists like J.D. Bernal, who was, in a sense, scouting the landscape of the eastern of the eastern coast of India for amphibian landing, and Archibald Vivian Hill, who came to take stock of Indian scientific capabilities in order to lead the war effort. However, the project in which Vishnu Mohan Ghadke, or Ghadke as I would like to call him from now, got involved, was led by was involving the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, which itself was created by donations from the Maharaja of Mysore, but also donation of land and some capital. But the key desire came to establish such a firm came from Valchand Hirachand, an industrialist from southern Maharashtra, who in fact had started out wanting to manufacture automobiles. And during the and as war broke out, he increasingly sort of also expressed interest in the establishment of aircraft manufacturing. And he submitted a couple of proposals to the British government of India, saying he was willing to put in capital for the assembly and manufacture of aircraft for war effort, which in his mind and you know the people who were working with him would lead to the capability and the capacity to manufacture aircraft in India after the war. Now the proposal did not actually receive any response for a significant amount of time, but it doesn't. I mean work on this project or such a project was not desirable for the British government of India as well. It is in 1940 that wheels begin to move and Ghadge is called in and the foundations for Hindustan Aeronautics Aeronautics Limited are laid. Now, it is what is interesting to note is that Ghatge begins to work or begins to lead the effort for the manufacture of aircraft, but at the same time his work in aerodynamics begins to unfold at the Indian Institute of Science, where again interestingly what he builds is India's first closed circuit, what is called a closed circuit wind tunnel. So I think if there are some aeronautics people in the audience, they might later explain it a little better than I probably can at this moment. At this moment, I understand cyclotrons better than I understand wind tunnels. Hope to get better at it, as time goes forward. And while he constructed the first wind tunnel at the newly established department, this was something that would become in itself the foundation for the construction of a bigger wind tunnel. And that story itself is also quite interesting, because what we have is at the end of the war, so 1945, so we have about 5 years of the assembly of warplanes and to some extent the design of smaller planes happening at HAL. At the end of war, when, as I hinted earlier, German researchers find themselves unable to carry out aeronautics and aerodynamics research, many of them started to move out. Larger facilities, of course, went to the United States and Soviet Union, and also to some extent to the United Kingdom. There were scientists and engineers who did not want to be drawn into the military efforts of the Allies, and they chose independent paths. Now, among them were scientists, but also aircraft designers and engineers, and two of them we will talk about in a little bit. But one such person was Oscar Titiens, and Oscar Titiens came in as the third head of the department of head of the Department of Aeronautics at the Indian Institute of Science. This is Oscar Titiens. I'll go back to the slide in a second, to the other slide in a second. Now, Oscar Titiens was also a Göttingen product and a star student one of the star students of Ludwig Prandtl. His name, of course, sounds Dutch, but he's sort of, Germanic, or German-speaking, of the German-speaking area, and had spent considerable time working in Pittsburgh before he went to Göttingen and then moved to Bangalore in 1947. So when he came to Bangalore, he teamed up with the person you see here next to Nehru, and of course in the mugshot that we have there, or the portrait photograph that we have there. That person is Otto Koenigsberger, and many of you might have actually heard of his story already. Otto Koenigsberger, for those in the science community, was the nephew of the physicist Max Born, who was in India between 1936 and 38, upon the invitation of Chandrasekhar Venkataraman to the Department of Physics. The stay wasn't particularly pleasant for him. He left after 2 years and moved, I think, if I'm not mistaken, to Dublin. But Otto Koenigsberger was his nephew, and he moved to Bangalore he first moved to Egypt from Berlin and then moved to Bangalore following his uncle. But Koenigsberger stayed on. And while this is not a talk to explore his architectural work, it is probably important to say that he laid the foundations of a school of tropical architecture. So today, the school of, the thinking on tropical architecture as a subdiscipline traces its origins back to Otto Koenigsberger. While he was here, he also worked for the Maharaja of Mysore. He designed several buildings on the Indian Institute of Science campus. He also designed refugee housing for people coming into India after partition in 1947. He designed the city of Bhubaneswar. But for our story, what is important is that he teamed up with Oscar Titiens to build the second and the larger closed circuit wind tunnel on the Indian Institute of Science campus. So for those of you who know the old Department of Aerospace, there's a protrusion on the right hand side if you're facing the building, and that is the shielding that was designed by Otto Koenigsberger that was the shielding designed by Otto Koenigsberger for the wind tunnel. Now, another important person to bring into this story is William D. Pauli, himself an incredibly colorful character. He was an aircraft manufacturer, and during the Second World War, primarily working in China, manufacturing aircraft in China, manufacturing, assembling various kinds of aircrafts. Now, Valchand Hirachand met Pauli while he was flying, I think, from Europe back to India. And they agreed to collaborate should Valchand Hirachand's project move forward. And they ended up collaborating. Pauli was involved in the facilities that were put together at the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited facilities. After he left India at the end of the war, not that he was stationed entirely here during the war, but he was moving around in this region to supervise the assembly and manufacture of aircraft. When he moved back to the United States, he was sent as an ambassador to South America, where he led a rather colorful life, and which involved, among other things, also murders and suicides. But his biography is also another interesting story for those interested to follow up on. But why he is important to our story is not only his meeting with Valchand Hirachand and his involvement in bringing aircraft for assembly for the use of war effort with Hindustan Aeronautics Limited or HAL, but before he left India, he instituted a bunch of scholarships at the Department of Aeronautics of the Indian Institute of Science, as a result of which a series of students who later went on to become leaders in the field of aeronautics and aerospace in India benefited from this scholarship, because this scholarship took many of them, or most of them, to Caltech. And among those we could name here are Professor Dhawan or Satish Dhawan. If I'm not mistaken, Professor Narasimha also received a Pauli scholarship, and there were a few others. At Caltech, the students going from India met again escapees and migrants from Göttingen. And so what you have is a triangulation between Göttingen, Bangalore, and Pasadena. Theodor von Karman was sort of the leading aeronautics and fluid dynamicist at Caltech. And himself having started out in Budapest, but then gone to Göttingen and from there to Pasadena. So von Karman, or a migrant for war reasons, I think Liebmann less so, although his move also from Europe was also informed by the political developments in Europe in the middle decades of the 20th century. These two people proved incredibly important for the training of the the next generations, the next couple of generations of students from India who came back and became leaders, not only at the Indian Institute of Science, but also at the later established, and HAL, but also at the later established National Aeronautics and National Aerospace Laboratory Limited, were trained with these people. So far, what we've seen is two waves of migration. So let me just kind of recap that a little bit. So in the first wave, I put people like Max Born and his nephew Otto Koenigsberger. In the second wave, we can have people like Oscar Titiens. Now, of course, so this is the second wave of German migration, but at the same time, one cannot forget the cross-migration of Indian students, not only from India to Göttingen and back, but also from India to Caltech and back, while meeting people from Göttingen. So there's a complexity here. There are Indians also involved, but for now, I'll focus on the third wave of German migration. Some of you might have heard of Tung, who was an aircraft designer, so not an aerodynamicist, not a university person, but someone who worked with the military aircraft manufacturers Focke Wulf during the Second World War. He designed some of the most important planes that were used by the Germans for the bombing of Europe, during the bombing of Europe. Tung and Willy Messerschmitt were two of the important aircraft designers at the end of the Second World War, who were desired by the Americans and the Soviet Union. So both were made offers, and especially in the case of Tung, he was made an offer both by the British and the Soviets. Now the story goes that Tung took 45 of his team members. And there is some, I mean, you know, I can narrate the story with some intrigue now, but if you want some more detail, which I might or might not have, I'm happy to take it up later in the question answer session. Tung and his team of 45 members it is said that they took some advance from the British and then disappeared. So they said yes to both the Soviets and the British, and then took them advance from the British and disappeared. What we know is that they went to the Vatican, acquired passports from the Vatican, and the 45-member team traveled to Argentina. In Argentina, this team worked with the regime of Juan Perón, and the assignment given to them was to build the first Argentinian jet fighter. The goal was also to try and build a supersonic jet fighter. So the team set to work. And in this picture, you see Tung right next to Juan Perón, who's, of course, you know, in the white jacket with his medals, etc. So Pulqui was the project that they embarked on in Argentina. The team led by Tung was in correspondence with people back in Switzerland, but also with Willy Messerschmitt, who by that point was heading. I'll keep Willy Messerschmitt for a while, who he meets later in Egypt. But they're working closely with their contacts in Europe to build Pulqui as a supersonic jet fighter. So what's important to note here is that in terms of aircraft design, Tung and his team are working on a new design. Now this design does not working on this. Now the other person involved with Tung was Emile Devoitin, who was from France, another emigre engineer, but this time from France. They worked together to design Pulqui. The project, again, I mean, it's a difficult. It was a difficult project because Argentina at that point did not have the industrial capacity for manufacture of such a plane, also at design capacity as a supersonic jet fighter, and so only, as far as my knowledge goes, only two of these exemplars were built, and by the mid 1950s, this was the case. Two of them were built, but also there were jokes made of the puliqui. So here you have basically, you know, an Indio person asking his pampero to try and beat the speed of the puliqui, and well, the puliqui is not reaching design capacity. So two were built, and 18 of Kuomintang's team members and Kuomintang returned to Germany sometime in 1955-1956. They returned because it was now possible for people working in aircraft design, aeronautics, etc., could come back to Germany. Things were becoming, one can't say normalized, but the occupation of Germany was not at its peak, and aircraft design was a possibility, and tensions, so to speak, had eased. After his return to Munich, it is what I was told when I, it's very difficult to rely on oral narratives of people, but I was told that Kuomintang met the Indian Minister for Defense Organization, Mahavir Tyagi, in a so-called decadent party in a castle outside of Munich, where Tyagi made the offer to Kuomintang to come to India. And in 1957, Kuomintang and 13 of his team members moved to Bangalore to work on what would become HF-24 or Marut, which was designed again as a supersonic jet fighter for the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. Now, by the time Kuomintang moved to India, Willy Messerschmitt had moved to Egypt. And this is an important aspect of the story for us, because Messerschmitt was in Helwan trying to build a jet fighter for the Egyptians. And what we know cursorily, I have not yet accessed the Egyptian archives, what we know cursorily is that test pilots from India traveled to Egypt and test pilots from Egypt traveled to India. So there was exchange of information, of experience, and of collaboration, so to speak, between the Egyptians, between the Egyptian team led by Messerschmitt and the Indian team led by Kuomintang on the making of these two aircraft. Again, and these papers I have seen from the Swiss archives, the test for the materials used in both Helwan and in Bangalore were conducted in Switzerland, and some of the calculations were also done in Switzerland. And in 1961, HF Marut had its first successful test flight, following which the manufacture of Marut as an aircraft for the Indian Air Force began. It is, of course, interesting to note here, apart from the Minister for Defense and officers from the Indian Air Force, for someone like me who has earlier worked on the history of experimental nuclear physics in India, it was interesting to see Homi Bhabha also at the launch of this aircraft. The aircraft was used extensively in 1971 in the war that led to the establishment of Bangladesh and the division of erstwhile East Pakistan no longer existed. The aircraft was seen to be very sturdy, although it did not reach design capacity again. It was seen to be sturdy and extremely reliable. And the reason it did not reach design capacity was that the engines required to reach Mach 2 speeds were not available from the British and were also promised by Bristol Siddeley to HAL and the team, and later denied. And the Indian team, both at HAL and the Minister for Defence Organisation did not feel confident about confident of putting in their own money into R&D to develop a new kind of a re-engineering of the of an engine that would make those speeds possible. What is interesting to note here is again some of the work carried out by Kurt Tank and his team also utilized wind tunnels at the Indian Institute of Science and facilities and, of course, manufacturing capability at HAL. So what we have here is a continuation of the configuration of the military and therefore the state, academia and industry coming together that continued not only during wartime, but was taken up again during peacetime by the third wave of German migrants to the city for the manufacture of HF-24. Among Kurt Tank's papers that are deposited at the Deutsches Museum archives in Munich, I also came across an edited version of the proposal for the establishment of the National Aeronautics and later Aerospace Laboratories, something he was deeply involved in, conversations with leaders who were later, responsible for the establishment and development of NAL. HF Marut itself became an interesting aircraft in surprisingly Eastern Europe, and one could actually buy kits for the making of making an HF-24 model in the Czech Republic and in Poland. So what is it that's interesting about this story? What's interesting on the one hand is German migration. One doesn't, in a sense, have oversight on, or it's not a part of our narrative of 20th century history of science to look at migrants from Germany involved in the establishment of what is a very peculiarly Second World War and Cold War military industrial academic complex. Not only are there three waves of German migrants, but there is a very strong connection also of Indian migration for studies, but a connection to Göttingen. So Göttingen as a center, Göttingen and Pasadena emerge as centers with deep linkages to Bangalore, which are yet to be fully explored. And needless to say, the Caltech is deeply embedded in the military industrial academic complex in the United States. And so how those patterns in a way play with each other, allowing for the progression of fundamental research, of defense, and of industrial manufacture. And I think it is the tracing this story through German migration gives me a good hook into exploring this story that is distinctly Indian. In fact, HF-24 has been called, India's first indigenously manufactured jet fighter. It no doubt was. But it was deeply embedded in an international network of learning, of design, and of manufacture, with also a very complicated moral landscape, which brought in what one might call mercenary aircraft designers who worked for the Nazis before and during the Second World War, worked for newly decolonizing countries like Egypt and in newly independent countries and developing countries like Egypt and India, but also emerging countries like Argentina. And so it's very difficult to square that politics with their politics during the Second World War. Also, their denial to move through Project Paperclip to the Soviet Union or to the United States, but instead actually working on aircraft design under conditions where industrial support was less than perfect, but perhaps it brought with it something else, which is something I am yet to articulate. And I think in both parsing out these threads, but then bringing them back together, lies the complexity of the very, very rich story of aeronautics research in India, starting in the middle decades of the 20th century, and then, of course, continuing long after. I haven't yet taken a decision on where I will stop this research story if I were to write this up, completely. But as of now, I have kind of framed it with the three waves of German migration and how that plays out, even during the war, with, you know, when the Germans were the enemies, in fact, but the connections to the Germans were strong. At the end of the war, we have people like Titians coming over here. During the war, we have people like Königsberger here. And we have Ghatge, who's trained in Germany. And then afterwards, we have Kurt Tank and his team. So thank you very much for listening. I will stop here and take questions. And I'm very, very happy for any leads and any, I'm sure there are people here who might actually know more than I do about this story, and to take it further. So thanks again. And I'm very happy for the opportunity to present this story to you today.
Thank you, Janavi, for this very intriguing lecture. And we'll take some questions. Whoever has a question may raise your hand and I'll call out your name and you can unmute yourself and ask your question, or you can type in your question in the chat box. I can read it out. Yeah, Mr. Narayan Sundara, please ask your question. Unmute yourself and ask your question.
Good afternoon. Thanks for allowing me to ask a question. So I missed the very initial part of your talk, but I was just curious because paperclip, it took the likes of Wernher von Braun and many distinguished, rocket scientists, aerospace engineers.
Yes.
I was very curious that, these people actually, I'm sure, a person like, Billy Messerschmitt could he not have gone to the US? So did you find any leads about why they shied away from, going to either the US or the USSR? It can't have been complicity in anything that the Nazis did, because people with paperclip was very benevolent, right? It overlooked a lot of things as long as the person was useful, right? They were just, they got a clean slate. So could you please share your thoughts on that? Why did they choose? I'm happy they came, but why did they choose this?
Yeah. So yes, of course, paperclip, benevolent is an understatement, right? Because they took people with very, very explicitly Nazi backgrounds to the Soviet Union and the United States. In fact, from Peenemünde, they took the entire facility, right? Like they just shipped the entire facility with the equipment to the United States. So paperclip would have allowed someone like Messerschmitt, of course, but also Kurt Tank. Kurt Tank was approached by the Soviets and by the British already. I can speculate. Given my reading of his papers in Munich and the little that I know of him, I know less so of Messerschmitt. I think they enjoyed the freedom that came with working in countries like Argentina, Egypt, and India. The other thing to note here is also that by the time Kurt Tank left India, he also went and worked with Messerschmitt. And collectively, they started working with countries in West Asia and South Africa, which was an exception. So they worked for Egypt, they worked for Jordan, and if I'm not mistaken, another country, so somewhere there. And they were accused by Israel of trying to circle Israel and put Israel in a dangerous position by helping these countries build state-of-the-art aircraft, an allegation which they have, of course, denied. But I think it's the freedom to design the way they want, even though this was under compromised circumstances, because they couldn't actually do anything to design capacity in any of the three locations that I have looked at. And the fact that they couldn't do their work in Germany, it was something they probably couldn't live with, and they weren't the only ones, right? Like, I mean, if you look at the number of people who migrated to Argentina, to Turkey, to Egypt and elsewhere, Australia, a number of them decided not to actually work with the Allies. And it could be a combination of several things. Occupied Germany was not a happy situation back home. They probably, and this is an angle that I'd like to explore further, they probably even had family members on trial. Or friends or colleagues on trial back home. And so I'm guessing it's a combination of these factors. I haven't found any archival document that gives me, you know, something concrete to hold on to say this is probably the most likely reason why they said no to going to either of the places.
Yeah, thanks very much for your answer.
Yeah, sorry, I don't have a more satisfactory answer. The archives seldom yield, you know, smoking guns where you kind of, unless you find a letter sometimes. It says, can't do this.
There are two questions in the chat box. First is by Sobhadra Hati. Why didn't India collaborate with USSR for Mach 2 engines after it was denied back? Then, as I think India was quite close to the Soviet bloc then, that of the Western bloc during the Cold War era.
So India did approach the Soviet Union. India was not that close to the Soviet Union at this point of time. The closeness began with Mrs. Gandhi, with Nixon and the growing distance between India and the United States, and then the growing sort of closeness with the Soviet Union. I mean, India at this point of time is talking about non-alignment, right? And also putting non-alignment in action and getting everyone from the United States to the Soviet Union, to the Germans, to the British, to the French coming and doing. I mean, if you look at the steel plants set up with help from various countries or just the IITs, right? You see how India was using a platform of neutrality alongside Egypt, Indonesia, and many other, and Yugoslavia and many other countries. To leverage exactly a position of neutrality. So coming back to the story, they did approach the Soviet Union, but the engines were not coming without strings attached, but also the Soviet engine at that point of time was not as reliable as the one that Bristol-Siddeley was making. And so it was a combination of those two reasons that meant that the Indians did not eventually get one from the Soviet Union.
The next question is by Sunaina. Lovely talk, thank you. I am a little curious to know a bit about aeronautical engineering that developed as a genre of study in IASC in the early 50s. Who were the teachers and what happened to the first few batches of students and whether they had any contribution in R&D and of HAL?
I mean, aeronautical engineering is not a genre, it's a discipline, right? Like it's a massive discipline in its own right. In the early 50s, who were the teachers? I mean, teachers, Vishnu Mohan Ghatke was around and up until R.G. Harris took over. After R.G. Harris left, it was Oscar Titians. So Oscar Titians would be the head of the department in the 50s. And there were several others as well. And I think some of them, the department actually brought out a lovely couple of books just last year, which are available on the website. So do have a look at those. And in fact, the Office of Communications should also was it deeply involved in bringing those out. So So Titians and his colleagues and others were there among the first batches of students. Professor Narasimha was one of the first students. Professor Dhawan was around. He was also a very, very important teacher after coming back from Caltech. If they had contributions to R&D of HAL, I think while the links continued, I think the separation was accomplished sort of fairly early on in the 50s, right? Like, let's put it this way, that the connection was the deepest when Ghatge was around, because he was pretty much managing the two facilities. But after that, while people remain involved in various projects, you see some of the exemplars of the planes actually put up outside of the aerospace department, which will give you, so one of Ghatge's planes is also put up there, and there's another one. So yes, so off and on, yes, but not with the same depth as it was, say, between 1940 and 1947. Yeah, so those were the years when the connections were the strongest.
The next question is by Sai Kiran Ramarapu. Great talk. Could you elaborate more on the connection between IIC and Caltech for aeronautic research?
Research. I think the connection was more in training rather than research. So you had... like I said, the Pauli scholarships meant that students from the department at IISc were able to go to Caltech to do further studies. So, basically PhD research and PhD and postdocs. But the scholarship was for PhD studies. And so that was the major connection. So research, as far as research projects go, individual collaborations would have continued, but institutionally, the training, like as in the educational connection was the stronger of the two.
MS Raghunathan, please ask your question. Unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yes, please. Say, I wanted to know if there was any contact between Subhash Chandra Bose and some of these German aeronautics people.
That is a question. Well, how should I put it? The eternal puzzle of the Bose who disappeared but did not quite disappear. I have no idea. But you mean specifically with Quartank and Millie Messerschmidt? Do you mean that?
Not really. Any of these people involved with aerodynamics? Not.
Yeah. Not. Yeah. Okay. So, to the best of my knowledge, not. So, I haven't seen anything in the papers that led that tells me that they even met. But I thank you for asking that question. I'll look into it, because that will make the story even more interesting.
Are there any more questions? Maybe we can wait for one more minute and see if there is any question.
Sure. Are there any people who in the audience who have experience of anything to do with Marut, or maybe know people who were Pauli scholars, or maybe know pilots who worked with HF-24? Or maybe I could ask another question, which is how many people were aware of aspects of this story, and have heard of the connection, say, between Argentina and Egypt and India and, the making of the first Indian. There's somebody, I think, who has their hand up.
Yes, Mr. Murali, please unmute yourself.
Yes, I just completed my PhD from NIAS. This is just a personal interest of mine. I've been following this story for a long time. And yes, I'm extremely aware of the connection of Kurtank to Argentina and then his arrival in India. Also the collaboration of Kurtank with Messerschmidt at Helwan and so on. But I think what you missed out in your story was the geopolitics, which was also developing at the same time. You see, the HF-24, as you rightly pointed out, the first flight had Homi Bhabha at it. So everybody knew why the HF-24 was being designed. It was being designed with the objective of possibly carrying an started appearing in the 1980s. Okay, so
there's
a background to why the HF...
Just a second. Could you just repeat the last two sentences? Your voice got cut, unless it was just my connection.
I said it was very clear that the objective of the HF-24 was really to be able to be a delivery vehicle for an atomic device. Mm-hmm. And that was something which neither the Soviet Union nor the United States was going to allow. That should never be forgotten. You know, so a lot of the story of that is hidden, and obviously there are no records in it, but inductive reasoning, I think, is the only way to to handle such situations, which is also difficult when you have no but you just can't miss that connection.
That connection, okay, I see what you mean. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, I think what you also must remember is that I'm a historian. I'm not, I don't do speculative work.
Exactly.
It was a supersonic jet fighter. It was meant as a war, as a war device, right? Like, so it was very clear that it was a military project. It wasn't a civilian aircraft. So that was very clear. About carrying an atomic device, taking a decision to build an airplane to carry an atomic device in 1957, I'm actually not so sure. Because, if you get the chance, do look at the book that I've written about the beginning of experimental nuclear physics in India. It's in the 1950s, people are still struggling to take that decision to jump in that direction, right? Like, so to sort of build an aircraft to deliver a device on which a decision has not been taken seems a little bit far-fetched to me. Certainly, it could have that capacity, but, like any other jet fighter could have. So, I mean, I'm not entirely convinced of that argument. If the decision to build the plane was taken in the 60s, around the Chinese test, for example, 64, if the decision was taken around 64 or before or around 64, it doesn't have to be 60, but it could have been between 62 and 64, I would believe that more. But it's difficult to kind of, it's difficult to make a contemplative claim of that kind, for absence of both conjecture. Or facts that converge, right? Like, so it's a war aircraft. There's no doubt that it was meant for that kind of work, but specifically for an atomic device, I have neither the evidence nor nor does my research lead me to that conclusion.
It's only conjecture. Yes.
Yeah, sure.
There's another question by Saubhadra Hathi. What was the role of Madras Institute of Technology during the 1950s-60s in Indian aeronautics? I remember a few professors of APJ Abdul Kalam were involved in Marut program from his autobiography.
So, Saubhadra, thank you for this question. I will go look up Kalam's autobiography and see if I find the names. If you remember the names of the people, please do drop them in the chat box. Again, I'll find it hard to believe because the IIT Madras project, if that's what you mean, Madras Institute, and unless you mean Guindy, because I don't know about the history of Guindy, but if you're talking about IIT Madras, it's only in the late 50s that the project takes off. And remember that, the Germans are not, so IIT Madras was built in collaboration with the Germans, and they are not explicitly doing aerospace aeronautics at IIT Madras. They are following the sort of guidelines largely laid out in West Germany. And they in fact set up various departments that could collectively address the question of aerodynamics and but not a specific department of aeronautics itself. The IIT Madras archives are just being set up, so I can actually look that up again because maybe this is something.
Excuse me.
Yes, please.
I'm Saubhadra.
Yes.
So I guess it was not IIT Madras and Madras Institute of Technology, both are different universities, if I'm not wrong.
Ha, so that's exactly why. So, okay, so you mean Guindy then? Okay.
Yeah, probably. And I guess it was Professor Sponder, if I'm.
Professor what? Sorry?
Professor Sponder, I think.
Okay, I'll look this up. I'll look this up. Thank you very much. I did not know this.
Page 17 of Winds of Fire.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
There is a comment by Darshit Thakur. I got to know about German connection with HAL from a recent episode of Cut the Clutter on Tejas aircraft by Shekhar Gupta on the print.
Okay, great.
There's another comment by Narayan Sundaram. Just to add to Janavi's point, IIUC as late as 1966, per a biosketch of K. Subramaniam, India had not decided to go nuclear.
Yes, my own work directs me to that conclusion as well. Up until 1953-54, Bhabha is obsessed with fundamental physics and, in fact, you know, trying his best to do work that would hopefully get him a Nobel Prize, right? Like, so 57, you know, to think of, yeah. So I agree with that. I think 64, with the Chinese test, the nuclear question is in a sense brought out into the open. And there is, for the first time, a public discussion on whether it is both desirable but also viable for India to go nuclear. So the discussion is on, but the decision is not in place. And therefore, the resources that would, you know, be put into it are also not in place.
Yeah, so Naina, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you. So I just wanted you to repeat, if you could kindly repeat about the two volumes that came out of IISc on aeronautical engineering, if you could kindly do that for me again.
I think Bithas knows that. That's her office.
Oh, okay. I'll write to Bithas then.
Yeah, it's 50, yeah, 50 years of Department of Health. Yeah, 50 years of, what's it called? 50 years of the Department of Aerospace Engineering, and the other is a commemorative volume for Professor Dhawan. So, thank you. Thank you, Abhinandan, for the information that this is ChromePate.
So, Bhadra says a little correction, Dr. Kurt Tank, page 18 of Wings of Fire.
Yeah.
Then okay. Professor Abhinandan has a comment. MIT is now part of Anna University, but its campus is not at Gundi. It is ChromePate in South Chennai.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that.
Are there any more questions? If there are no more questions, shall we call it a day today?
Sure.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Janavi, and we hope to have you again and with another topic, with another, you know, interesting lecture. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope to take this project to conclusion not too far in the future. Thanks a lot.
So many has said thank you to you in the chat box, and they have said it's a wonderful lecture.
Thanks. Thanks, Sita. Very kind of them.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye.